My name is Melissa Morris, and my current position is I'm an operations team lead for the completions group in the Eagleford at Shale. Grew up in Michigan, born and raised, was in the Detroit area, and figured that my career plan would be somewhere in automotive. I like a challenge, I like things that are difficult, that force me to learn, that look hard, and I like to be intimidated. When it came time to go to college, I had my mindset on law school. And I thought, okay, well, I've got to do something else in the meantime. And growing up, every once in a while, my dad would pipe up and he'd say, you know, Melissa, engineers do that. They can work in oil and gas, they can work in automotive. Almost every industry that needs to design or build something has engineers. And it was right up my alley, and that's how I ended up in engineering and just loved it. And I still went to law school, wanted to go just because it's a great experience, good broadening. Certainly something that can never take away and you'll never get another chance to do. So hopefully I will have passed the bar, which is later this month. But then I'd like to use that to broaden out a little bit and get some different experiences through the Shale culture.
So how's the studying going?
That's okay.
What's the game plan for today?
Evidence. So I started again halfway through it yesterday, but I think I have to do that one.
How far along are you total studying for the bar?
35%, I think that's pretty
good. Good to go.
So I'm supposed to be a little further, but that's okay. The oil and gas industry does have a bit of a bad rep. I think people tend to think of oil and gas in the old techniques. You just sort of poke a hole and see what happens. But the reality of the oil and gas industry is very, very different. And that's what draws, I think, most of us to it, is that the amount of technology that goes into extracting the oil and gas is pretty impressive.
So see you Tuesday?
See you Tuesday.
All right.
Love you. Since I spend a lot of time in the office, my focus is on being able to spend time out in the field. And so every 2 weeks, we'll go out there and talk through face-to-face with everybody in a room what issues we're having. But the field is actually over near Laredo. The closest city would be Carrizo Springs, but it's about an hour north of Laredo. So typically when we head to the field, we'll go through San Antonio, roughly a midpoint of it, and then we can just stop along the way. Hey, you know, I just want to let you know, I just got to the hotel, so I'm probably just going to study a little bit, maybe go work out and get some food and then turn in. Got to get up fairly early tomorrow morning to get to the field, so probably just hang out here. All right, love you. Bye. As an engineer, we're mainly focused on the pre-job planning, so working out the logistics, working through the operational steps on how we want this to be done. What's the safe way? Do you run tool A or tool B? At what speeds? How do you need to run it to make sure that we've got a successful operation? The area that Shale has in the Eagleford is a contiguous about 100,000 acres that our operations are currently working on. The first stop along the way is at the D26. We'll check out the drilling rigs. They're about 3/4 of the way through the lateral. See how they're coming along. After that, we'll check out one of the hydraulic fracturing spreads over on the D19. If we've got time, we'll check in on the coil tubing unit, drilling out some wells over on the D18. And then we've also just brought in a workover rig to do some tubing running activities for us. So we'll see how many of those we can fit in before the meeting this evening. Our biggest focus is on the safety and on the environment, because that's our license to operate. See, we redid it. Although, this casing valve, did we turn that when we were doing our work on it? Because this one's oriented wrong. Often, I think when we think of a cleaner energy future, we're often thinking about the fuels that go in, but really the focus is on that entire process and how we take it from cradle to grave in the sense of tracking where that fuel goes and how it's used and how it's burned and leveraged.
Which was a 54-inch clearance from the center of the wellhead to the edge of the base
boom. Yeah.
That turned out to be an incorrect rig up on the yard up there.
Okay.
The actual measurement is 36 inches.
Oh, that's a lot different.
So
we've just pulled up onto the D19, which is a hydraulic fracturing spread. As we walk out there, the main focus is looking around the location, just looking for anything that doesn't look safe, anything that looks like it could be done a little bit cleaner. If we can clean up, prevent trips, slips and falls are a big concern, especially on a hydraulic fracturing spread because of the sheer amount of equipment.
For what we're doing in a workover application with 2 3/8 pipe, and you just about have to turn it over to lose a joint in that valley.
Yes.
So okay. I didn't see the need of it.
Okay.
If you were going to run bigger pipe, and if you were going to pick up big pipe with it, I would say yes,
put
you needed something taller on it.
Oh. Yeah.
But with the little pipe, and as far down in there as that's going to sit, I couldn't
that
see
makes
the
sense.
Need for it.
This is nice. I mean, it's extra, but it's a lot safer. At this point, everything's looking good. We're running smooth and, of course, running safe and no issues or no concerns today. So we'll just head back. We'll look at what we can do and what we can do to improve on our consistency and our efficiency. What I like the most about this industry is that it's a little unpredictable. You never know what's going to happen. And you're constantly problem solving. It's a lot of reacting to the problems of the day and really a big focus on what is it that we need to line up to be efficient and how do we improve? So what metrics can we look at and how do we make sure that tomorrow when we go out there we're even better than we were today?
Sending them, John, but could we send just kind of a quick follow-up reminder email to those people who are still outstanding?
As you start to dig into the particular characteristics of a fuel, you start to learn what does it take to produce it, how do I transport it, how do I store it, what is its shelf life, what can it be used in, and as you start to come up with the operating envelope, if you will, for that particular fuel, you start to see where the opportunity for it is. And I think that's where the real advantage in terms of this clean future is not so much focusing on what's the miracle fuel that's out there, but it's about understanding what our options are and figuring out the operating envelope for each of those fuels, and then deciding how we best leverage that fuel in the overall world economy. The real advantage of being in the office is the face-to-face interaction with the engineers. So the majority of engineers do sit here just down the hallway, and then the superintendents were sitting here, and it gives us the ability to really, before we even write a procedure and send it out to the field, we can go through and address HSE concerns, the way we design a job, make sure it's safe and it's gonna operate effectively.
So what well are you drilling at the moment?
Right now we are in the Eagleford, South Texas.
Oh, you're on the D26. That's actually where we were yesterday.
Oh, you were on site actually.
Mm-hmm.
The real satisfaction for me is knowing that it's a challenge to keep people safe, keep people focused, keep things efficient, keep things running. At the end of the day, I don't think there is a difference between how we perceive the world and how a, quote, environmentalist would perceive the world. Everybody's out there on a day-to-day basis making sure that we're keeping the environment, in many cases, trying to leave it in a better condition than when we arrived. And the best reward is when I can make a little step towards that.